In the case for the government to bend.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is a well-known fact that the U.S. has one of the largest economy in the world in terms of GDP. It is still today nearly double that of its next closest competitor, China. $17 trillion in wealth is an almost unfathomable amount of money. Yet in spite of all that wealth that we've amassed, this week we received a warning from the International Monetary Fund that our nation must do something about how we handle poverty in our country, otherwise our economy and our society will face dire consequences. Today, we have 2 million individuals who are homeless on our streets. 45 million individuals in this country live below the poverty line, where their basic needs of food and shelter are not being met. It is clear, abundantly so, that the current welfare state that we have established does not work. It does not adequately care for those who need help. That is an issue. We have a patchwork system, a Frankenstein system, if you will, where we see an issue and we decide to assign a set of bureaucracy to that that has targeted funding, most of which goes through administrative fees, and quite frankly, it resembles alphabet soup. We have SNAP, TAMF, CHIP, Section 8, EITC, WIC, SSDI, and so on. This patchwork system that we've established each has all these different entities that suck in their own special way. We propose something far more simple and, quite frankly, far more effective at dealing with these nation's problems, both economically and socially. And we were going to reform how we handle the welfare state as a whole. This is what's called a universal basic income, a citizen's dividend, if you will. This is a lump sum of money that every single citizen, regardless of wealth that they currently have, or their working status, or their capabilities, will receive with no strings attached to do with which whatever they will like. We will not restrict what you can buy or where you can buy from, like what we do with other programs. Currently, it's means tested, our current welfare system, which means once you reach the poverty line, we cut benefits. That won't happen. We're cutting a check for Bill Gates, too. Every citizen has this as a fundamental right in this country. The amount? The poverty line. We're going to give each individual about $1,200 a month to live on. Where would it come from? It would replace a majority, I'll take you in a second, of the current welfare system that we currently have outside of Medicaid and Social Security, as citizens have already bought into these systems and they need to be paid out. If we need extra money, we can implement a carbon tax or an asset tax, which every single other developed nation currently has to fund these types of programs. There's money out there. If we can spend $1 trillion on a failed campaign in Iraq, we can take care of our country's poor. Go ahead.
Sorry, you're my colleague over here.
I'll take over.
Awesome. So, do you think the most efficient way for us to stop poverty in the United States is to cut Bill Gates a check? Or should we instead focus on the people who actually need money and instead implement something along the lines of an earned income tax credit that doesn't have work disincentives and doesn't have a cutoff point but still doesn't waste money cutting checks to billionaires?
Right. The amount of billionaires that would actually receive a check, quite frankly, is very small. We think establishing this as a right to every single citizen benefits mostly the lower class individuals who actually need this money, as well as the middle class individuals who are most affected by the burden of poverty. We think this is generally a good thing. And not only is it principally and morally superior, but pragmatically it's more effective, and I'll explain why as I get into my case. We think that the two values that underpin American democracy is the society and the economy that we've crafted around it are freedom and creativity. When we maximize these two things in our society and allow individuals to access these principles and embody them in their day-to-day lives and how they choose their profession, we often see the greatest periods of wholesome prosperity and happiness. And often this is accompanied by a whole entirely more egalitarian society. The freedom allows you to determine for yourself what you ought to do with your life. You don't have the government telling you what you can or cannot spend this money on, what you can or cannot access as an individual. You can pursue your own careers with this money. And quite frankly, we also think derivative of this freedom is the limitless creativity and ingenuity that individuals pursuing their own passion are far more productive than those who are trapped in wage slavery, forced to work jobs that are essentially dead ends merely to put food on the table. No thank you. We think that these are all things that are good to maximize, and this was first recognized by Abraham Maslow 200 years ago, and now we're finally just getting around to talking about it. We think this is generally a good thing. This creative freedom spurs innovation and new industry. The ones that our economy desperately needs right now is traditional jobs are being lost to automation. This is what we need currently, more motivated and determined individuals to excel at what you do. The poor currently fight to merely get by and survive and put food on the table while everyone else has the luxury of pursuing their own careers and what they want to do and how they want to contribute to the economy. The problem is we have too many poor currently who are unable to contribute to the economy and as a result are a burden. So yes, on the whole, this is far more effective at dealing with these issues and will be far more productive as a whole. I'll take closing now.
Yeah, so you've talked a lot about how the current welfare system is somehow broken, is not solving. So with your universal basic income, are you replacing the welfare system or just adding on to it?
Yeah, I said that in my model. We're replacing most of the programs outside of Social Security and Medicaid, which have already been bought into. And yes, Bill Gates will still get this check, so I imagine we'll hear this. And likely he'll put it in the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundations, but it'll go back to the poor anyway. So we don't necessarily see that as an issue either. So let's talk about the pragmatic benefits in this round. Empirically, this type of system, no thank you, has been proven to increase access to education, lower incidence of mental illness amongst the poor, increase society's overall health, reducing healthcare spending, and reducing poverty on the whole. From India to London to our neighbors to the north in Canada, every pilot program that has been launched with a universal basic income has, if not entirely eliminated poverty in that area, has effectively reduced income inequality by producing more productive citizens who can incorporate themselves into the economy to create and contribute meaningfully to that economy rather being stuck in a poverty trap working below the poverty line. Quite simply, your average citizen, each and every one of us, will live a better life. High school students are no longer pressured to go find work as opposed to either finishing high school or pursuing a college degree. We have less high school dropout rates. And quite frankly, mothers, single mothers particularly, don't have to rush back to work to provide for their family. They have that extra income on hand, so they can spend more time caring for the development of their child. You have healthier children overall. Virtually in every single category, a universal basic income will improve the lives of everyone in society. And we think it's ridiculous that instead, we prefer the patchwork system that we have in place. We think it's about time that we implement something more effective and more wholesome, and for once, those who most desperately need the help amongst us will actually have it. Thank you.
Before I start, of course, we said this earlier, but we're really happy to be here to come halfway across the entire country to come debate. Really honored, great guys everywhere. That being said, let's jump in. It's interesting that the Prime Minister's solution to income inequality is to give Bill Gates more money. So even though we must do something, why don't we do quite possibly anything else? The solution to a bad system is not quite possibly any other system. We're going to talk to you about why, although the current system's problems are bad, why the problems with those are also problems that we can solve on our side of the house. So yes, the welfare system needs reform, but it's mostly because it's underfunded. It hasn't been fundamentally changed since the 1960s and the advent of the Great Society under Lyndon Baines Johnson. So I think what we can actually look towards is a more functioning welfare system, yes, but we don't need to give everyone a living wage every year. Sure, this only affect a few billionaires, but on our side of the house, we can implement things like conditional basic income, where if you make more than $20,000 a year, we don't supplement your income massively. We think that is a clearly less restrictive, better, and more efficient way to get all of their ends without randomly, literally, setting money on fire. Okay, what else do they tell you? They come up here and say, hey, this allows people to get freedom and creativity, really get their juices flowing. So here's the thing. Yes, it's good when people have more money. I think, and people are better off in general. I think we're going to make arguments about why we do that better. But the reason why we have conditions to welfare in the status quo is because this is not these people's money. It's the taxpayers. The collective invests in the individual. As a consequence, we have to make sure that people's investments actually pay off, that they are reasonable, that they are being invested well, rather than just being given to not help people. And I don't think we're trying to paint a picture of, man, people are going to go out and do welfare, Koreans are going to buy lobster with their money. Instead, I think what happens a lot of the time is conditionalized welfare allows people to make sure that they are protecting dependents, their children. So sure, maybe you know it's in your best interest, but maybe you need actually to be conditionalized to make sure that you spend in your child's best interest as well, because they aren't spending the money. Next, they talk about how automation is just going to fiat and make this actually necessary. So, no, in the status quo, we've actually seen that there isn't any tangible increase in unemployment over the long term, over the medium term, rather, as a consequence of automation, an increase in unemployment. Instead, more jobs are still created, as we've seen with every technological advancement since the beginning of the agricultural revolution. No thanks. Then they say that I should make this quick point in response to the POI that, hey, we're also going to keep Medicare and Social Security. Why? These are still welfare programs. These are still welfare programs, just like all the rest. And in addition, you're still giving people money. Why would we give people universal basic income and also give them Social Security? Finally, they just give you some studies about how this means people get more education. So all the studies that have been conducted in the United States regarding universal basic income were made in the Chicago suburbs in the 1980s, and all the attributable benefits in education are actually attributable to the entire United States as a whole. Sure, people got more educated, but so did everyone else in the United States at the same time. It's not attributable to basic income. With that, we're going to give you some substantive arguments about why we think that this is profoundly bad, why we wouldn't do it. We're going to talk to you first about why basic income is unjustified and conditional welfare is preferable. So taxation is the government taking away your money. We think there has to be a really high bar for that to happen in the very first place. As a consequence, we make sure that when we're taking people's money, we're using it to fund other people's rights. Think about this. You don't have a right to $30,000 a year under the Constitution, under our collective system. What you do have a right to are basic goods and services to make sure that you can live freely. For example, a right to food and health care. We provide that better on our side of the house, and we have conditionalized welfare, like the SNAP program in the status quo, or like just access to Medicare and Medicaid, rather than a private system. Now, in addition to those being philosophically better, because we're actually just fulfilling people's rights rather than giving them money, making sure that those rights are fulfilled, which is the primary obligation of the government, it's also pragmatically a whole lot better for three main reasons. One, the government can do it more cheaply. They can either buy in bulk products and services, or they can just do things like supplant Medicaid, which isn't looking to turn a profit. That's why it's a lot cheaper than just giving people money and saying, go to the private system, which is absurdly expensive. Secondly, though, we can also remember that it's a lot easier to navigate. So why should a single mother, for example, who needs to worry about her kid's education, have to go and figure out which type of healthcare she should buy when the government can provide one that is cheaper and just more simpler for her? Moreover, they won't also be subject to predatory schemes and decision fatigue. Finally, though, we also want to remind you that different people have different needs. So someone who's disabled probably needs more money to spend on healthcare than someone who's not. And we think that this is fundamentally unfair in that respect. And even if people, you can apply the argument I said earlier about how even if people do have their best interests at heart, I'll take closing in effect. Right, closing up? Cool. Even if people do have their own best interests at heart, it's not necessarily of independence. What's up, closing?
Oh, you like a question?
Oh, didn't I say that? Oh, sorry, bro.
All right, so you talk about using more targeted welfare programs such as like food stamps or anything like specific like this. However, can you provide a tangible impact of where this has actually been effective or actually given benefits or reduced poverty in the real world?
So reducing poverty. So when you give people money that they would otherwise have, they reduce poverty because you have more money, but it doesn't get at the point of whether or not it should be conditional. The reason why that's better is because we make sure that people are spending their money on their dependents and on the rights that the government has a primary obligation to actually provide people rather than something else. With that, we're going to talk about why this is actually extremely bad for the economy. So if you're little-skilled and can't seem to get jobs that are above the minimum wage, no reason for you to get a job in the system at all. Moreover, even if you have higher medium skills, right, you're like middle class, you still actually might want to fall back on this. Sure, you'll make half as much money, but you have all that free time. You never have to commute again. You never have to go to work again. So in a cost-benefit analysis, people will easily want to actually go do this. But the problems with this are obvious. First, less work means less output overall, and it becomes harder for us all to become better off, richer and more prosperous in the long run. But second, as more and more people take the basic income, you need more taxes on the people who are still working to actually make sure that people are going to fund this. This means that it leads to a spiral and kind of a race to the bottom. As people don't want to work even more, as a consequence, the people who are working have increased and higher taxes. This also has really negative social implications. Think about all the rhetoric in the status quo that's already used to deny the poor a basic standard of living, right? You go on cable news, welfare queens, people buying lobster with their food stamps. Now, when people actually do get access to do these things in the real world, which isn't the status quo, most of those are lies,
Then, this rhetoric gets even stronger. Suddenly, they are legitimized in a meaningful way when people actually can't access this. Moreover, we can also remind you, like, think about what people are going to do to try. Think about, like, the rhetoric surrounding the welfare state and the status quo and immigration. All of the people, like, a lot of the right wing right now, says, well, it's hard enough for, like, the documented immigrants to receive benefits on Medicaid, to receive subsidized housing or public education. Think about what's going to happen when we actually provide basic incomes to everyone who comes here, or at the very least, citizens. This means that people want to fight back against this and actually just stop immigration in a meaningful way and prevent more people from coming, because they don't want people to be perceived, or at least get the perception that people are just coming over here, taking our welfare benefits. It makes this all the much worse. The final argument we want to briefly advance is about how a conditional basic income is obviously preferable. Why would we waste money on Bill Gates? Why would we do this? Instead, we can just happily give money to a few people, and we think it's a much better system. So proud of those.
Points, which are going to be the role of government and why the government should pursue egalitarianism, I have a brief bit of rebuttal to get through from the last speaker. He asked us why we would give this money to everyone, and that's really the crux of our argument, okay? Because first of all, the United States has the highest rate of donation. We think that what's going to happen when you give people like Bill Gates this money, it's going to trickle down, right? You're going to get donations, and you're going to get people who are encouraged to do so because you see political figureheads and people in power doing so. Secondly, it's going to set a precedent because everyone is equal in the eyes of the government. We think this is going to be transcendental, which is going to be a lot of my case, right? Because we think that when the government says that everyone is equal, people start to act in such a way that says, hey, you are equal because the government said so. But finally, we think we're going to continue to give people to Social Security and Medicare simply because they bought into it, right? They asked us this question of why would you continue to dole out this money that is a social welfare program? And we think absolutely, right? But at a point in time when people buy into it, we think that that's something that necessarily we ought to continue. But the main argument they give us is that the government should fill fundamental rights through welfare. We think this is pretty absurd, right? Because we think that fundamental rights extend far past just food and water. My partner talks about Maslow's hierarchy, right? Your fundamental needs include the need to self-actualize in order to create your own dream, right? The American government has set the precedent that we want people to be able to pursue things like freedom, freedom to express yourself, freedom to create your own dream, something that we think that we establish within this model. We think that this isn't cheaper currently when we continue to exist within the social welfare program. Rather, it's going to be more expensive in the long run because what we were doing is entrenching people within these cycles of poverty, right? When you continually give people the amount of assistance that they need to simply stay afloat, they're never able to break free of that. Moreover, when you strip people these rights as soon as they've got their head above water, we don't think that that gives them the means to continue to excel, to continue to progress and excel. Furthermore, we don't think that giving people $1,200 a month, namely middle-class families $1,200 a month, they're going to suddenly quit their jobs, right? I think we can ask anyone in this room, if you're giving $1,200 a month, you're not going to quit your job. That's absolutely absurd. Rather, with case studies that we're going to bring you, people are more encouraged to engage in the market, to pursue things like higher education, things that are going to be better long-term for society. So on to my first point, the role of government. No, thank you. On the most fundamental level, we feel that the role of government is to help people, but moreover to help people who cannot help themselves, something that we think that the government, the opposition bench, has thus far failed to address, right? Because we think that on their side of the house, we don't really get help helping people. We get keeping people afloat. What this means extends far past simply protecting people. Rather, it means helping people pursue American values of ingenuity and self-creation, something that we think is very important for the future of our country and for the future of progression. Our model provides this benefit in two ways, fulfilling both economic and egalitarian benefits. We're going to take care of the economics first, since I think that's what the last speaker really wanted to address. Most likely, we will spend less than this on this program than we will spend on our current welfare state. Why? Because we cut out things like bureaucracy, which is very expensive, which provides a band-aid for a solution that is much larger. Government is really good at writing checks. That's something that we know. They're not good at fixing problems. We think that on our side of the house, we're going to get a lot of fixing. But secondly, the net benefits we expect to get with this new egalitarian president is colossal. Because to explain, we're going to look at Namibia, an entire nation in which this worked. What they did was significantly reduce crime rates because you no longer had crimes of poverty. You got increased employment rates, especially with new business startups, innovation, increased outputs into the community. You got better overall health and less state spending on health because people were able to take care of themselves. And you got more students involved in school, maybe because their parents were selling them to sex slavery or something like that, but that's kind of beside the point. because these students went to school and were more attentive, were more willing to pursue higher degrees and not being sent out to other forms of work when they should be in school. No, thank you. We've seen programs implemented with similar success in London, Canada, cities within the United States, Brazil, India, and they have all been very successful, right? We think empirically proven this is going to work. But when you have a government helping people, they begin to help themselves. The turnaround we expect from this is clear. We think we're going to get lower crime rates, reallocation of bureaucratic spending. We think we're going to be stepping outside of the welfare program that entrenches people in these cycles of poverty by barely keeping them afloat. This is very important because you're going to get things like increased civil engagement, because if people feel like the government is no longer disenfranchising them, they want to partake in this. They want to continue to engage in social progression. And they actually have the means to go out to the voting booths and vote because they're not like struggling to stay above water. Instead, they can afford to take the hour off work that takes them to go out to the polls. But perhaps most importantly, what we get is increased education, something that we think is very important, because now instead of a high schooler being forced to work a minimum wage job during high school instead of focusing on his grades and getting to college, or single mothers who are able to go back to school, parents who can save for their children with this lump sum of cash every month to go to school to pursue higher degrees and better jobs, or perhaps women who are historically disenfranchised, discriminated against, lower wages, lower employment, and other forms of discrimination. Heck, we might even get another female debater in the college debate showcase with this program.
So you
assuming that this gift we're giving to the American people is going to be at the same or at a higher monetary value than welfare in today's day and age, how can you possibly say it's going to be feasible to expand it from a small percentage that are in need to every single person in the United States of America?
Right, because instead of more people who are getting introduced to the welfare system because they are not working and they're getting entrenched within the cycle of poverty and they're barely staying afloat within the social welfare program, we think that they're going to be able to self-actualize, right? We're going to look at a case study of London in which people gave the citizens this lump sum of cash, and 50% of the people who were given this lump sum were actually able to get housing on their own volition. Homeless people who the government could not help because they did not understand how to properly allocate the funds. We think that it's very important to give this to the individual because they know how to do this and they know the necessity to individually deal with their finances. No, thank you. So finally, why we should set egalitarianism as a national priority. Clearly, governments, political figures, etc., establish precedents for not only how society should function, but also how society members should interact. This functions in such a way that socioeconomic classes are mobilized to engage and interact with one another. So we're going to see poor people engaging with middle class engaging with rich, which ends the stratification, which entrenches people within their poverty, within their social economic class. To be clear, our model is an agency for change, because no longer is government simply keeping you afloat. The government is helping you to do things like self-actualize, because it's literally allowing for people to create their own lives and successes, something that we think is very important, especially in a Western liberal democracy such as the United States. Because instead of the paternalistic approach and status quo, we get people who are given tools to be individually successful, something that we think is very important, something that we don't think exists within status quo. In London, we saw this work, right? Because people were able to act within their own volition. People became more successful because they did not have the paternalistic big brother of the government telling them how they should spend their money. Instead, they were able to do so on their own volition and in turn became more successful down the road. So social precedent becomes clear in three ways. First of all, the role of government is not to keep you afloat. It's to help you engage and succeed in the idea of building your American dream, one that you can determine. Secondly, literally doling out the same lump sum of cash equally says that the government believes that we are all equal, that we're all able to excel and ascend. This becomes transcendental because when the government stops disenfranchising people and discriminating, the common man will do the same. We'll see each other as neighbors. We think that everyone should be free in their pursuit of happiness. Thank you.
Mainly what we heard coming from the government bench was a lot of flowery rhetoric about how the purpose of America is to foster creativity, foster the American dream. And look how well our effort to foster the American dream has worked in all these other countries. The two big problems with that are, first of all, literally every system they mentioned, Nambia's system, London's system, the pilot programs tried in the United States and Canada, every single one of those was mean tested. Basically, what they did is essentially they worked more like a negative income tax, which is effectively like the earned income tax credit. That is, when you make more money, you still get additional funds, but if you make over a certain amount of money, then you don't actually get additional money. We think that is a better system because it doesn't just give money to people who don't need it, first of all, and second of all, it makes sure that the government can provide for basic needs, which we think is more philosophically consistent with the role of government. A couple of points that I want to advance to sum up our argumentation. So, first of all, philosophically, They tell you that the role of government is to broke creativity and broke freedom. They cite Maslow a lot because they don't have any philosophical underpinning for their argumentation. But Xavier gave you the arguments, which essentially demonstrate clearly the reason that the government has an obligation to provide certain welfare services to people. Because fundamental rights aren't to be creative. Fundamental rights are things like having housing, having food. We think that those things are uncontroversial. The reason that their argumentation is wrong is because whenever you increase the freedom of someone below the poverty line, their analysis says you are doing that by reducing the freedom of someone above the poverty line by taking away some of their money. They never warranted to you why the government has less of an obligation to provide for Maslow's hierarchy of needs for somebody who already has a lot of money versus somebody who doesn't. They never gave you the clear distinction there, whereas only our side is clearly differentiating the sorts of goods and services that ought to be provided to people in the lower class. We think that it is 100% true that the government has an obligation to make sure that individuals have their basic needs met. We think that if people's basic needs is above, like, essentially getting your head above water, they should provide for that too. However, providing someone in the upper middle class a check for $3,000 a month isn't an obligation that the government has, especially when it comes at the cost of taxing someone who happens to be in a slightly higher tax bracket. And we don't think that their argumentation, their philosophical framework, is sufficient to support such a system. I'll take you in a second. We think that on our side of the house, we are more philosophically consistent with what the obligation of government is, which means that prima facie, you have to essentially not accept their system. Let's talk about pragmatics a little bit. Why are mean-tested systems that essentially don't just cut you a blank check, but instead help people access the services that they actually need, why are those better? We gave you a bunch of reasons. They responded to literally zero of them. First of all, it is cheaper to buy in a large volume. When the government is buying a lot of services at once, they can buy at a discount. That's why when you go to Costco, things cost less. They say, no, the private sector is always going to be cheaper. The reason that it's not is, one, because it's provided in lower volume. As an individual, you have less bargaining power in things like the insurance market. You don't have the ability to say, yo, insurance company, or yo, this given hospital, we are only going to essentially take your contract if you offer us a lower deal. No, when you're an individual operating in the market where you don't have the time to go out and shop around at different healthcare facilities, it means that you have to individually pay a higher rate. On our side of the house, the government essentially can take advantage of economies of scale and lower costs. The other reason is because the private sector, when you're entering into that, is taking a slice of the profits. When you have a 20% or 30% profit margin, that means that every dollar the government is giving in essentially a universal minimum income, 30 cents is going to people who are already wealthy in terms of like buying and selling services throughout the economy. We think that it is more efficient when the government operates those services and doesn't have to operate at a loss. But Opening disagrees.
Maybe if I got $1,200 a month, I might be able to afford to shop at Costco. Ladies and gentlemen, their system that they currently propose is far more expensive. We spend $1 trillion a year on welfare versus about the $500 billion we'd spend here. And then they would make it means tested, where once someone gets a breath of fresh air, they would strip the benefit, forcing them back down under the line of poverty.
Alright, so we heard a wonderful rehash of the arguments that I just responded to. The problem with every single argument you just heard is that, one, again, it is cheaper when you have economies of scale. Two, Xavier already preempted that when he said the reason that the current healthcare system doesn't work is because we haven't touched it in 30 or 40 years and because it is severely underfunded. Those aren't reasons why it's fundamentally broken, and it's not responding to the underlying argumentation that I've given you as to why it is more efficient and more effective for the government to operate these. But that doesn't even matter, because that was only the first of the four reasons that Xavier gave as to why means-tested welfare is a lot better. It's also much easier to navigate. They're telling you that people below the poverty line don't have the time to go out to the polls and vote. They don't have the time to become informed about candidates. So what makes you think that they have the time to essentially shop around with different healthcare systems, to figure out which school they're going to essentially send their child, to look at all the different daycares and pick the best solution? We think that if it actually is true that these people have so little time to essentially make those decisions, then it is better and simpler for the government to simply say, look, this is what you have available, we're not scamming you, you don't have to worry about accidentally squandering your money on something that's essentially a scam, try to trick people into essentially getting these services. Again, zero response. I think they also forget that different people do have different needs. So while it is true that if you are below the poverty line, not everyone below the poverty line is equal. Like, they're not all the same person. They don't have the same needs. Therefore, if you are disabled, you probably need things like disability benefits. If you have additional healthcare costs or you're older, then you probably need additional medical benefits, which is what the current Medicaid system provides and what a reformed version of it would do as well. Also, if you have a child, then you need things like childcare benefits because you have additional expenses associated with living. We think that when they treat everyone as having the exact same needs, then you don't provide for those very needs that they say are a fundamental right. At the end of the day, they're not providing for what people actually need. Also, they forget the point about dependence, which is essentially like, yes, we think that in the vast majority of circumstances, people are going to treat these things well. We think that's not categorically true. We need to protect people who can't protect themselves. What else do we hear? They try to tell you that we entrench cycles of poverty. Now, again, the only reason that the current welfare system doesn't do a good job is because it is underfunded and outdated. They never give you any inherent reasons as to why providing for basic needs doesn't give you the ability to earn your income on top of that and then use that money to essentially fulfill your dreams. Next, they try to tell you that, like, look, we need to encourage people to go to college. We think that why would you essentially hope that people are encouraged to go to college instead of doing things like paying for college. They say, we give money to rich people, well, the money's just gonna trickle down. If the goal is to get money to people who are already impoverished, don't give money to rich people hoping that they'll donate, just give it directly to poor people and essentially do a means-tested system. All of their arguments are basically just reasons why we shouldn't continue to feed the current ballooning costs of things like healthcare and education and instead do a means-tested system where we actually provide for the needs of people who actually need those things. So what do we give you on our side of the house? We give you a system that is not only philosophically, but also pragmatically superior.
All right, first off, I'd like to thank PolitCon for inviting us and the judges for being here. You could be anywhere, you picked us. So thank you for that. So before I get into all the technicals, I'd like all of you to envision this. Imagine it's 2016, and it is. And we all have universal basic income. That's like a safety net, right? If I fall back right now, there'd be a net behind me. There's no net, so. Mm-hmm. Yes. Now you have more opportunities to pursue your dreams. Now you have opportunities to maybe drop the hottest mixtape of 2016. And to respond to the opposition, you spoke about conditional basic income. So if a family earns more than $20,000 per year, then they don't get that money, right? So what if there's a family of five, but they earn about $30,000 per month? They probably need that money. Mm-hmm. Status quo is failing us. And UBI is the remedy for that. And to go off Prime Minister, what's your name again? Tanner. Yes. 45 million people are below the poverty line. I got bad news for all of us. It's actually 50. That's bad news. So we give everyone around, say, hypothetically, we give everyone $3,000 per year. That could cut the poverty line in half. And we've never seen effects of UBI before, not in the US. But in 2008, now we've implemented this. For 1 year, they have conditional UBI. And the results were poverty fell from 76% to 37%. Crime fell 42%. Why? Because you don't have to steal money anymore. Yeah. My man, go ahead.
So, if conditional basic income is so good, why don't you implement conditional basic income as we've been advocating and not universal?
Okay, I think when I said conditional, I meant universal. I confused you there. But, yes. So yes, we will implement universal. Another example. Mid-1970s. In a county called Maninova in Canada. They implemented basic income too, also called MINCOM. And the results were, over those, I think, 6 years, there were fewer hospitalizations, not right now, and then fewer mental health hospitalizations. More adolescent males were willing to graduate because they don't have to look for jobs, because they have that safety net. It's probably one of the two greatest things that ever happened to Canada, the other being Drake. With UBI, we will be able to fill the gap in employment in jobs that need less human power. So, you know, remember that scene in that Willy Wonka movie where the grandfather gets fired from factory because they're not using machines now. Jobs like that will be gone. But yes, with UBI, they don't have to worry about having jobs like that anymore. 25% of workers today need public assistance. $9.5 is not enough. $15 per hour is not enough. And in the next 2 decades, 47% of jobs will be replaced by computers. It's about to be the Matrix. So we do need a remedy for that. Yes, please.
I'm a huge fan of all the movie references.
Oh, yeah, me too.
So I'm sure the grandfather Willy Wonka would rather, you know, still have a job instead of having to rely on universal minimum income. So wouldn't it make more sense to just do a means tested system? If you lose your job due to automation, we do what the United States currently does and instead provide for things like job retraining to make sure that you can still continue to participate in the jobs that are being created by automation. We think that if you increase the funding to that sort of system, you get all the benefits you're talking about without having to cut Bill Gates a check.
Increasing funds for automation or?
For job retraining programs, which is a means tested system, which I think would be an awesome idea.
I think most jobs that are being replaced by automation are the ones that are minimum wage, and those are entry level jobs. So, you know, you can't make a living off that. And yes. And so, you know, UBI is the replacement for that. If that answers your question. And this issue also has bipartisan support. So, you know, you're Republican, you're anywhere on the political spectrum, everybody seems to come together on this. So it starts off with a vision. If we don't have a vision, we don't have results. I'd like to end with a quote by Martin Luther King. In his 1967 book, Where Do We Go From Here? Which is a very good question. I am now convinced that the simplest approach will prove to be defective. The solution to abolish it directly by a now widely discussed measure, the guaranteed income. So my speech may end now, but the dream will never end.
I'll get some thank yous out first. Thank you, everyone, the audience, for being here. It's nice to debate in front of an audience and not in front of an empty room, so this is definitely good. And then Politicon for giving us an invite and our judging panel for sitting in and hopefully being entertained, and hopefully someone up here or in there learned something today, right? Because that's really the point of all this. So without much further ado, let's get into the arguments. So Switzerland, in just recently, the past month, was pressed with the issue of having a universal basic income in a country that guarantees paid vacation time, a country that is far more progressive than we are, with much more of a welfare state. Switzerland voters rejected the universal basic income 77% to 23%. What this tells us is that even though they know that while it may have some benefits, they're not willing to go all in on it because they know that there are so many risks, and that even in as progressive a country like Switzerland, they're not willing by large margins to accept this policy. So I want to get to first sort of what the closing government team talked about, then I'll address the opening, and then get to our case. Closing comes up here, and they tell us that like $3,000 a year is going to be this amount of money that allows people to like drop mixtapes, right, and like rise out of poverty. But that's about $250 a month. That's not really going to be enough to do anything. So if $3,000 a year is the amount that we're working with, it, like maybe it helps with one car payment, but when you're abolishing all of those other welfare benefits that on the whole, people who really need the money are not going to be able to get the resources or access to resources that they need, not at this time. So it also needs to be mentioned, I think, that the average welfare payout of the United States government right now is about $25,000 per household. Obviously, richer households don't get as much of that. Poorer households get more of that. But what they do with their system is they say, well, that doesn't really matter. We're going to give rich people and poor people the same amount of money, which means effectively, people in poverty, people who are low income, are not going to get the same amount of benefits from a lump sum of money that they were getting from welfare benefits that can provide for things like healthcare, for things like food stamps, for things like families with like TANF, like also like extra aid for single mothers, things of that nature, where people really need extra, right? And their plan doesn't allow for that. Then secondly, I'll talk a little bit about this point about jobs being replaced by computers. A universal basic income only makes that come faster when minimum wage labor isn't as important to people because they can be getting paid, as they're saying, to subsist without actually working. No one's going to want to work minimum wage jobs. Those employers will have to raise their wages to attract labor, meaning that those employers are going to say, instead of raising wages, let's just mechanize and move to more autonomous systems like robots. So it's just to make that come faster. So what did we get? What did we get in the front half? They told us that, first of all, this is going to be very fiscally responsible. It's going to be cheaper than the current system that we have. But this isn't true. It's going to be fiscally irresponsible. They say it's going to remove all this bureaucracy of the welfare system that exists. It's going to create an entirely new bureaucracy of this universal basic income, right? That's going to be massive and extremely costly. Secondly, then, when they're giving it to every person, including, as they say, Bill Gates, so that he'll, like, donate it, right, to help people, move out of poverty, that, like, that's a cost that they're incurring on the system that doesn't exist now. So we think that ultimately it's fiscally irresponsible, particularly when we're at $20 trillion in debt that we can't even afford it as it is.
Sure.
Right, to clarify, the amount that they're getting is $1,200 a month, enough to keep them above the poverty line. Would you not concede that when people are able to stay afloat above the poverty line, they're able to do things like pursue higher education, to pursue jobs that are not minimum wage, something we shouldn't even be dealing with right now?
Yeah, I think people should be above the poverty line, and I think our front half brought up a lot of reasons like why alternatives work better at doing that, but I'll bring up a disadvantage as to why their system allows someone to fall through instead of how it is now where you fall onto a safety net, they will fall through because there's nothing there. They're abolishing all of those parts of the welfare system that exist. So let's talk about now our case, right, which is like we're going to bring 3 points to the table. First, that it's going to curtail the incentive to work. Second, that it removes a crucial safety net. And thirdly, that non-citizen residents of the country will be extremely disadvantaged by this, and that will massively increase the inequality of the people living here. So first, a UBI, universal basic income, is going to curtail the incentive to work, right? Right now, the United States has among the lowest labor participation rate in our history. 20% of males ages 18 to 35 aren't even in the labor market. But there are jobs available, right? We've experienced 53 straight months of private sector job growth. So that means that there are jobs for people, but people are not participating in the labor market. So what happens then once we pass their plan? Well, it rewards inactivity and decreases the incentive for activity. Because right now, if you want to do more, you want to have more money, likely people say, well, if you work, that's the way you will get more money. That largely doesn't apply anymore once it says that you don't even have to work and you're still going to get this $1,200 a month. So then economic production will go down, right? Businesses won't be able to find labor, especially low-wage labor, because someone will say, if I can get $1,200 a month, then that's going to be enough for me. That's about as much as I would get with a minimum wage job. So it's not worth it then to work. I'll take that.
All right. Is it not true that having a universal basic income is not going to be enough to completely satisfy a lifestyle of health, nutrition? It's not going to be able to completely fulfill all the requirements that you need to survive. You still are going to have a job. You can't simply rely on only $1,200 a month. Is that not true?
I think there's a lot of people that could do that. But I think, especially if you abolish like Section 8, then you're right. Then there are going to be a lot of people who will not be able to afford their housing. And even then, the plan that you pass won't be able to gain the benefits that you say that it gets. Now let's talk about how this removes a critical safety net, right? So right now, we have a means-tested system where it says, depending on how much like you need something, depending on what kind of poverty you're in, we will treat you like equitably with your situation. Theirs abolishes that, but what else does it get rid of? SNAP, TANF, Section 8, the Earned Income Tax Credit. Now, Section 8 is for affordable housing, right? Rent, which is obviously one of the things that like people have to pay the most for, is what Section 8 deals with. So it says if you are low income, the government will help subsidize part of your living, right? And oftentimes, more than or about like $1,200 a month, right? But they're getting rid of all of that, meaning now they're going to thrust onto people who can't afford it, them having to also pay full rent, which is going to be a massive increase. Look, we have to be clear that like there are a lot of ways that people could possibly run out of this money that they need, right? There's misbudgeting. People can just make bad decisions. But also, poor and elderly people are like the biggest targets for financial scams. Once we give them this money that is not tied conditionally to anything, then once that disappears, there's nothing left for them to go to. There's no safety net. They will fall through, be out on the street. Look, we think it's imperative that we urge a vote against the universal basic income. It's not going to decrease inequality or increase economic production.
All right, can everyone hear me? All right, before I get started, I would like to say a big thank you to all my opponents here. I'd like to say thank you to the judges, and I'd like to say a big thank you to Politicon for hosting us today. With that, let's go ahead and get started. I think at the end of today's debate round, we need to look back at one important fact, and that is that poverty is on the rise, and people are not living a good quality of life. Today, people are struggling to meet basic needs, basic necessities, and that is because the current welfare state is failing. As we stated and seen very clearly in today's round, it is not working with what we have in the status quo, and there's no reason why that's going to change if you see an opposition ballot at the end of today's round. So I'd like to show you very clearly how we uphold the resolution, and ultimately, by supporting this resolution, you're going to see a decrease in inequality, and you're going to see economic gains in the United States. So let's first begin with the empirical success. I believe that this is one of the most important arguments to look at the end of today's round. Now, in their last speech, they came up and talked about Switzerland, and they said, recently Switzerland passed, or they looked at a proposal, and they considered a proposal to implement a UBI. But the problem with Switzerland is they already have a well-established welfare network. They have a high quality of living, they have a good quality of life. There's absolutely no reason to put in force something like this when they already have such a high standard of living. There's no reason to completely switch systems if what you have is working. However, the United States is different. What we have is not working. No questions at this time. Let's move on to my next argument under here, which is that of Namibia. I think this is a very important country to realize, has been extremely successful. Looking back at my partner's speech, he said specifically that poverty fell to 37% from 76%. That is a large drop, a significant drop. If we can see a drop that significant, there's no reason why we wouldn't want to pass the UBI. Yes.
So we don't care about whether or not the income of people is above a certain point, but rather we make sure that the quality of services they're getting is of high quality. We gave you reasons why the government can provide higher quality of services if they're providing for a welfare system, and the voters of Switzerland agreed that that system is better than universal basic income and said it's better to have a means-tested system. So insofar as in Switzerland, where you have a good government system that is based on means testing, why should we instead look to a system that is not that when voters have clearly made the choice that like one is better than the other, and we provide you lots of reasons that's why.
All right, Switzerland is a completely different country. They have a different economic and geographic situation from the United States. However, to look at your argument, there's been two proposals or ideas from the opposition team. The first is that we would give them this amount of money up until a certain cap. I believe $20,000 or $30,000 was mentioned. Either of which would not be enough money to support a strong, healthy, and good lifestyle. But the next argument that was made was the argument specifically that we should stick with the current system. And what do we see? The current system is failing. With that, let's move on to my next argument, which is that it is economically feasible. I believe it's important to understand that what's working is what's happening right now is not working. We have very stagnant wages, we have economic failure, we have unemployment at all-time highs, and automation is on the rise. With automation on the rise, there's no reason not to have a UBI, because this is going to compensate for the loss in wages that will occur through automation. So let's look at the first argument under this, under here. From the closer.
Yes. Now, the thing you're leaving out is it's not just American citizens that get welfare, but it's the hundreds of legal residents that can get welfare every year. With your program, you leave those people out. You say only American citizens get money. Everyone else, sorry, you're out of luck.
I don't think that's true. We're going to be giving every single American citizen a certain amount of money, $1,200 per month. I don't understand how that's relevant in this debate. We're going to be providing more quality than we have already. With that being said, let's move on to my next argument. Again, when we look at this, we see that this is the cheapest alternative. As my opponent said in their last speech, it is very clear that this is going to be cheaper than what we have right now. We're going to be saving billions of dollars. Not to mention this is going to simplify the system. And by simplifying the system, removing multiple programs and simplifying it down to one UBI, we're actually going to reduce complexity, which thereby thought will improve the economy. But the next argument is actually that commerce is going to increase. We're going to see economic rises. If we look to the history, we see that this is increased. According to Professor David Tao, he said that commerce significantly increased. It led to more business overall when it's been tested in numerous different countries. Yes.
So you said that universal system is simpler, but we told you specifically that when you eliminate all of those welfare systems, then you have to essentially replace all of them and find your own healthcare, do all those sorts of things. So which is simpler, having to spend the little amount of time that you have shopping around, or essentially to essentially have the government do all those logistics for you?
When we put the job in the consumer's hands, it's going to be a lot more, they're going to have much more maneuverability and ability to use this money to better survive and better provide for themselves. With that being said, let's move on to the other argument. Another argument that my opponents made in today's debate round was that education will improve. And I think this is very important. Now, when I look at the resolution, it doesn't say anything specific about improving education or improving specifically the amount or type of education that's occurring. But what we need to understand is that when we see improvements in education, as we saw in Manitoba, for example, where a UBI was implemented, we're going to see significant economic gains. When we have citizens that are more highly educated, they're going to have higher paying jobs, a higher quality of work, and ultimately a higher quality of life. When people have the opportunity to have more of an education, when they have higher education, they're most likely going to receive more success, and they're going to receive higher income, higher wages, and ultimately this is going to lead towards more progress in the future. So, education, although it may not specifically relate to today's resolution, is important in today's debate round because it's going to contribute to the economic gains that will occur. Under the next point, we must look under specifically the resolution and what it asks for. So at the end of today's debate round, the most important thing is that the government team upholds the resolution and meets the requirements stated by it. First off, we must reduce inequality. How to do that? It's very simple. When we reduce poverty, we reduce inequality. And at the end of the day, when you're handing someone more money than they're receiving today, when you're giving them more benefits than they already have, when you're simplifying the system, they're going to be reducing the amount of poverty that they experience. If you give them just $1 more, that's a reduction. And all we need to see is a reduction, not an elimination. But the next argument, again, is that we must see economic gains. And I think it's very clear that economic gains will occur when we have a cheaper and more simplified alternative. Yes.
So we agree that education is good. Why not just implement President Obama's plan, for example, to give people free community college or subsidize it to begin with, rather than giving them the money and allowing them to pay for college, which the government can do more cheaply, more easily?
Okay, I don't think that really has anything to do with today's debate. We're talking about a universal basic income, not really a college education provided by the government. I don't think that's really relevant. That's like brand new. We haven't heard about that until just now. But at the end of today's debate round, I think it's very clear that we're going to alleviate and reduce the amount of poverty that we currently experience. Poverty is a huge problem. I think it's very clear that the welfare state we're in right now is not solving these problems, and the only option we have is a UBI. And UBI may not be perfect, it may not solve every single problem in the world, but I think we've sufficiently proven that a UBI will reduce poverty and will improve the economy. Thank you.
I think the problem we've had in this debate is a problem that we often get in collegiate debate, something that actually was pointed out by the front half of opening, is that up on this stage, we have 7 white males that are debating about an issue that's going to affect a lot more than just that group. Now, what do we mean by this? It's not only... Let's get to the actual issue here, though. Okay, guys, let's calm it down, okay? Let's get to the actual issue up here, which is the fact that not only is their system filled with redundancies, but their system leaves behind a significant portion of the population that is in the most need. America is not just made up of its citizens, but it's made up of all taxpayers, of all legal residents. That is what makes this country great. It's the diversity here that allows anyone to succeed. We think they're leaving them behind for no reason, and they don't give them the safety net. That's the safety net we take away. That's the actual pernicious harms of their plan. What I'm going to do for you is I'm going to try to clarify this debate because it's been a little bit messy, and I get that. I think there's 3 main areas that we need to address that I think will show really where this debate is going to end. The first is going to be, what is the role of government? The second is going to be basically the pragmatism of this plan. And the third we're going to talk about is the actual effects on the people. So the first, let's look at the role of government. So first of all, as we saw in opening, should government be a totally egalitarian system, right? They say out of opening government that, look, we need to be egalitarian. Everyone should get the same amount of money. We're not going to give poor people more money than we give rich. This is simply false, and this isn't how the government works, right? That's why we have a progressive tax system, because there are some people who have been advantaged both by the system and by their own doing that therefore can help out the people that have been disadvantaged by that same system. Okay? We see that there is a difference in the way the government treats people, because the government's job is not to just treat everyone blindly equal, but the government's job is to equally protect every person's rights. That's what we saw out of opening opposition, right? Our front half told you that the government is taking away your money. Now that is taking away an inherent freedom, right? To do that, there must be some significant benefit that you're getting. You can't simply take away all these people's income without any actual substantive benefit. That's a serious infringement on their rights, and that's what the government must try to avoid. Now, the next part where you see is they completely miss the idea, is that everyone doesn't need the same amount of money. Right? We see someone who's a disabled veteran might need more money than someone who's just a little bit down on their luck. We see that there's a differing scale, and by treating everyone in a completely black and white point, in just a completely universal point of view, you actually miss out on the minutia that allows social program, welfare programs to ever work. It's that it's given to you when it's needed, that way we have more to give you when you need it. That way we can target it so that it helps you get out of that situation that you're in. We don't give out needs simply to give out money. That's not how things work. That's not how you make things better. Let's go into the second point, though, of pragmatism. This is where we see the actual issues. Before I get to that point, I'll take your view on
it. Right. Started off this speech saying we want to provide a safety net for those that are unaccounted for in the plan, and then wanted to strip it for those that are accounted for in the plan, i.e. the rich. The problem with the means-tested system that they quasi-advocate for is the second anybody gets anywhere, you pull the rug out from under them, and they're back where they started. This is why we advocate for the rich.
We're not going to tell you that the welfare plan is perfect. Now, we don't need to have some reforms. What we're going to tell you is that your system is inherently flawed, both in the pragmatics and in the principles we saw in the opening. Now, that's where we're going to go into the second point of pragmatics. Why did the plan not work? So now the first thing we need to talk about is those redundancies. Because you see a key thing, and they say, well, we're still going to give people Social Security and Medicaid because they paid it. Okay, so now we're paying all these people who have Social Security and all these people who have Medicaid more money in addition to the fact that we're already giving them money. There's one redundancy. The second of all is now we're giving it to everyone, even people who don't need it, right? So if we use a conservative estimate, a very conservative estimate, the U.S. population of like 300 million, let's say, incredibly conservative, we're still giving out $432 million every single year. Now, that doesn't seem like a little bit of money like they're saying. Now, they're saying, look, we have zero bureaucracy, but that's simply not true. We don't just, like, put out a pile of cash and let everyone go pick it up. There still is the same governmental organizations that need to make sure this money goes out, make sure the system is not being taken advantage of, and make sure people get it. They don't actually save any money. We see it's horribly unpragmatic, and they give all these examples, right? So when my partner comes to you and gives you, or my opening half, gives you the example of Switzerland, look at how great that turned out. The closing half says, well, Switzerland is not the U.S. It doesn't work. And we say to the same effect, yes, Namibia is not the United States. Because something has worked in Namibia does not mean it works here. But more importantly, even if the plan that they are advocating for wasn't even put in place in any of these studies, the fact of the matter is, Namibia and Switzerland, all of these status were needs-based, guaranteed basic income. Now, we have no problem with guaranteed income based on needs. We have a problem with giving an income unnecessarily to all of these people. That increases the redundancy of the system that doesn't actually serve the benefit that they are espousing. Now, let's look at the last point that we really need to talk about in this debate, which is the actual effects on the people, right? There's three sub-points here. This is largely brought to you by my partner. The first is basically... The first is that it's going to allow for more of a mismanaging, is it takes away the safety net. Now, what do we mean by this? Is when you give people welfare money, it's earmarked, right? It's earmarked to helping your child. It's earmarked for food stamps. It's earmarked for housing. It's earmarked for medical care. However, what you see on their plan is they're just giving money. So yeah, we may think it's great that now someone can spend all of this government-given money to help drop the newest mixtape. We don't think that's a smart way to break the cycle of poverty. Right? We think that there's a reason why money is earmarked, because it helps people get out of the cycle. We don't think it's perfect, but we think it's the best way. By giving these people money, we take away the safety net. Because we simply say that when you're out of your luck, you're out of luck. We gave you some money, and sorry you didn't spend it. Right? We don't think that's the attitude we need to take. The second and most important point is going to be that it values U.S. citizens unnecessarily. Now, in the current system, anyone who's been a legal resident for 5 years is able to get welfare benefits. In their process, they want to strip that away. They say that's irrelevant, but that is not irrelevant. That is the most important point here. Is not only are you just having redundancies in a system, but you're having redundancies in a system that is still going to leave behind a huge portion of the U.S. population that's going to say, well, sorry, you lost your job, but you weren't born here, so I guess you're out of luck. Now, we don't think that's fair. We don't think something as arbitrary as your citizenship when you've worked here and lived here for 5 years warrants the government saying, we don't have anything for you anymore. They want to strip these welfare benefits. They don't want to give anything in return. We think that's a problem. Yes?
Right. We tried to make this last round about citizenship, right? That's not what we're talking about. The question we have for you is, would you rather have a rich white male telling a family of six that they need 8 loaves of bread a month when they actually need 10, or have the family be able to decide for themselves and
we'd rather give the aid to those in need. And we'd rather not leave behind the people who aren't, like we said, okay? That's simply not the issue, okay? What have we shown you today? We show you that the role of the government is to help people in need, not to blindly give out money. We think the second point is their plan is simply not pragmatic. It has redundancies, and it costs way too much money. And we see the third point is the actual effect on the people are going to be harmful. We leave behind the immigrant population, and we allow mismanaged money. We don't help anyone. We hurt them. We're proud to oppose.
Thank you, debaters, for a wonderful and spirited experience on the role of universal basic income, and thank you to the audience for paying attention and being very responsive. It's always a lot of fun to be back in debate. Ultimately, it was our decision and our thought that the government side relied on the notion that poverty is bad as the main philosophical framework for their argument. The opposition agreed that poverty is bad, but responded in a way that presented the fact that universal basic income was not the only choice by which we can solve poverty. It is for that reason that we have sided with opposition and have agreed that universal basic income is not the best way to alleviate poverty in the United States.
Yeah, man, we have a few points to make too, so go ahead.
Sure. This is my first experience doing this, so I would just say a couple of things. First and foremost, you guys make me feel a lot better about the youth of America. I'm serious. I mean, you read all this stuff about kids on college campuses, and you know, I won't go in. I won't go in. Yeah, especially you guys. You know, the young guys. But I just thought everybody was terrific. And I don't know if this is appropriate or not, but I would single out you. I'm sorry, I don't know everybody's names, but
Tanner
and
Justin.
Yeah. You guys are both terrific. Just very, very sharp arguments. I would say to you, Justin, that my only piece of stylistic advice would be I cover Congress, I cover campaigns. I've spent a lot of time around politicians who are brilliant and have very, very pointed and articulate arguments to make. But it's the old, you know, more flies with honey than with vinegar, and I would just watch that a little bit, because I think that sometimes you can take away from the substantive strength of your own, you know, argument. It's just my two cents. You can, you know, disregard it. But either way, I just thought, you know, both sides were outstanding. And we can get into some specifics.
Oh yeah, you know, some really great points that I saw from you guys. The one thing that I both really liked and thought could have come from the side argument for universal basic income a little bit, was you touched upon it, the egalitarian kind of the equality thing. Talking about more the role of government protecting people's rights, almost maybe going in a 14th Amendment direction. We were kind of thinking, you know, we talk about cutting checks to people. That's, you know, if you look at the founding documents of the government, there's an argument to make that it's pretty far out to, you know, be giving checks for this and checks for that. And I think tying that more to the efficiency and cutting the bureaucracy, even though there were some very good points from Yale and UCLA talking about how, you know, their own bureaucratic hurdles.
Yeah, and the conversation on rights certainly led in favor of opposition, because although you presented a very correct assessment of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you didn't respond to that. The government's role is not necessarily, and has never been, to say that you have a right to self-actualization. Right? You have a right to a certain set of rights, right? Housing, food, so on and so forth. To which, right, UCLA made a very good argument saying that you are going to take these rights away from a certain set of people if the limitation is on US citizens, right? If you're on an H-1B, you don't get those same rights. So that is innately American, right? Immigration is a great thing, despite what Donald Trump might say. So that is important. And also the conversation on Section 8, right? Vitally important, because if you're only leaving Social Security and Medicare, you do create massive amounts of holes, right? So $1,200 a month, right? You know, coming from people knowing, you know, on Section 8 is not going to be enough to cover, right, that plus the 8 or 10 loaves of bread. There's also the conversation on decision fatigue, which was perfectly articulated, right? So if you are now going to, if people and, you know, sort of government have made the point that you won't be able to, if you can't vote now, right, because you have to work an extra hour, to which opposition said, well, if you can't vote right now, how are you going to have the time to go through, right, the healthcare change and choose out of hundreds of policies, right, which some of us in this room have been through? And that takes more time, really, than looking at which candidate to vote for or taking the hour to vote. That you're, there are certainly responses that you could make to that, which is personal choice, which was brought up in the end but not articulated more, which is ultimately people have the choice, and if you want to make that sort of a burden on them for that choice, then that's a fair argument. But it wasn't coherently, or it wasn't expressed nearly enough to refute the point that there is this fatigue, that there is a benefit of scale on the government side.
Yeah, but the one specific point of argument that stood out to me was that I think three of the four of you, if not all four of you, made reference to the fact that the current welfare system is broken or is ineffective. And I think many people on either side of the political aisle or of any ideology or worldview would agree with that, and many of them would say that has something to do, if not everything to do, with bureaucratic incapability. For me, it's very difficult. You faced an enormous burden in arguing that because the welfare system is broken, we need to vastly expand it. That's a very difficult argument to make. I think I was disappointed that you guys did not in any way address the just how, if we're talking about another massive federal mandate, some sort of top-down, one-size-fits-all from Washington program, I would expect some argument about not only scale, which you did effectively, but also about the implausibility and maybe the how impractical it would be to try to address that to folks who are living in Los Angeles, where the cost of living is very high, and also in Kansas, where the cost of living is probably $120. For me, that would have been a very strong argument to try to explain that, not everybody would need to draw, even if there was some framework for universal basic income, why not at least talk about doing this from a local or a state level rather than just another one-size-fits-all federal program?
Great. And then any questions from you guys for us?
Thank you. Thank you.